Welcome. This is a history of modern philosophy, and my name is Mark Thorsby. In this video series, we are tracing a number of key philosophers within a survey, looking from Descartes and working our way towards Nietzsche. If you'd like to follow along, the book we're using is Classics of Philosophy, edited by Pajman and Vaughn, published by Oxford UP. So please follow along with us. If you don't have access to that text, all of the texts we're looking at are freely available online. So welcome back, everyone. I hope you guys are doing well. Today we're going to be looking at the next major important sort of philosopher within the Western tradition. Keep in mind, so far we've looked at Hobbes, Descartes, Spinoza, Leibniz, John Locke, and we also looked at Pascal as well. So these are the different philosophers that we looked at. Notably here, we've begun our second section with Locke, by taking a look at British empiricism. So remember, empiricism is the notion that knowledge comes through our experience. British empiricists are the first philosophers to really argue for this in a systematic way, and they're from Britain. Pretty simple. John Locke is the key sort of first thinker when it comes to British empiricism, the notion that all of our knowledge comes from our experience. To be clear, there's a couple things that are worth mentioning before we get into Berkeley here that are important to think about Locke. Number one is, remember, Locke has a notion that the mind is a tabula rasa. So knowledge is gained through the accumulation of our experiences. Locke talks about the idea of knowledge ultimately being about the agreement of our ideas. So ideas play a key role. What is an idea? Recall there that for Locke, we have sense experience, and then from that sense experience, we have both simple and complex ideas that are generated from out of that. And then by reflection, we can then further infer even more complicated ideas. But at the core of the whole thesis is that the atomic element of our experience and the sorts of knowledge we're able to gain rest with the simple ideas we gain from our perception and our experience. Also note that we saw that Locke argued that we can't ever know with certainty that corporeal matter actually exists. We assume it does because it seems to be the best explanation for things. But strictly speaking, the only things we have experience of are ideas. We never actually experience directly the world that our ideas seem to be representing. So consequently, there's this removal of the subjective experience from the objective world in John Locke that's important. And we'll see it's quite notable in terms of its relationship to the philosophy of George Berkeley. So those are some of the key things. One thing that is worth mentioning too, we'll see almost immediately comes up in our reading, is Berkeley here is attacking John Locke on a number of different fronts and in a number of different ways. But one of the key things that he's concerned with is Locke's conception of language and ideas. One of the things you'll recall, there was this section we read and discussed in John Locke, where John Locke said that what seems to happen is we get these ideas in our experience, and then we give those abstract ideas names. Right? So we have these simple ideas that develop into complex ideas, and then from there we can build even further, more complicated and complexes of ideas, but that our words ultimately represent these ideas, and these ideas represent features, aspects of the world as such. So that's a really important thing, because we're going to see that this means that our knowledge of the world is fundamentally based upon an abstract ideas, and the language we use is also functionally dependent. Both of these claims George Berkeley strongly disagrees with and will argue against. So let's sort of get into it. He's a great philosopher. I really love Berkeley. There's a number of key texts that he has, including an essay towards a new theory of vision, a treatise concerning the principles of human reasoning, which is what we'll be taking a look at, and then the three dialogues between Hylas and Philonous. That last one, it's included in the textbook. I'm not covering it, but I encourage you to read it. It's a great sort of, it's basically a great dialogue that explicates the ultimate position of Berkeley here. So you should really read the treatise and the dialogues together. We're going to be reading an excerpt here in just a moment that's been subtitled On the Principles of Human Knowledge. So we're going to be really taking a look at that today. Now, George Berkeley lived from 1685 to 1753. He was the Bishop of Clone in Ireland from 1734 to 1752. So he was a bishop and a devout Christian. And you'll see today how his philosophy is related to his views in theology as well. We're going to see that he held a number of really key ideas. One of them I don't have listed there, but that would be his rejection of abstract ideas. So he rejects the model that John Locke establishes, which ultimately means that he rejects things like the distinction between primary and secondary qualities, which he specifically critiques. But for his part, Berkeley held that there's really two types of reality, if you will. There's the mind and there's mental events. But notice here that this means that he's ultimately an idealist. Oh, I think I skipped one. Because he's known for developing, to a certain degree, the version of what we call metaphysical idealism. You'll recall from the taxonomy of philosophy, the very first video in the series, we said that there's a number of basic positions in metaphysics. From monism, we saw that with Spinoza. Dualism, we saw that with Descartes. Another, materialism, we saw that with Hobbes. And then finally here we see idealism. Idealism is the notion that ultimately reality is fundamentally just ideas. And we're going to see a sort of simple way to explain it is, if you go back to John Locke, because we're not able to have direct access to matter, we only have perceptions of its aspects, right? I only have the five senses that give me access to, here's a cell phone. When I hold the cell phone, it's through my five senses that I'm able to appropriate it, but I'm never able to appropriate the corporeal matter that is itself, the being which it is, right? And because of that, essentially what Berkeley will do is utilize what's known as Occam's razor. Occam's razor is the notion that all things being equal, the simplest solution tends to be the correct solution. In other words, okay, we have these five different experiences, five different modes of experience to feel the phone or any other object, but we don't have an experience of the direct matter, the corporeal stuff that it is. And all things being equal, if we don't have access to it, then why are we supposing it exists? And we're going to see that Berkeley essentially argues this, is that the whole notion of matter is a flawed notion, and that ultimately reality is just ideas. So we can give up the notion that we have bodies altogether. And so it's a very sort of provocative and interesting thesis. Now, that's why he thinks that there's two types of reality, the mind and the mental events or the ideas that the mind experiences. Now, we're going to see his key principle here is esse est percipi, which means to be is to be perceived. And the primary notion there is that anytime we say that something exists, we say it exists because we perceive it. And if we're not able to perceive it, we can't know if it exists. So given that's the case, we can say that the first condition, in fact, the necessary and sufficient condition in order to know something exists or is real, is that we can perceive it. So that means that existence equals perception. When we perceive, something exists. And when something exists, it has to be perceived. So perception and existence always go together. And since they always go together, right, that essentially seems to be the primary principle for what it means to know what's really the case, right? And this is going to raise a big question of, well, wait a second, if to be is to be perceived and there's no material reality, then how is all of this working? Because it looks like things do have material relations with each other, but if they're just ideas, what sort of relationship do they have? And we're going to see that God plays the key role. So Berkeley's idealism ultimately depends for, I think, its final comprehensibility on the notion of the divine. So, but you can see here, there's an interesting relationships to a number of the previous discussions we've had. So I want you to think about those. Now, in just a moment, we're going to go through the reading. And what I've done is, as I've done in the previous couple of videos, we're going to go sort of step by step through the reading and discuss a number of the passages and quotes that I think are really key. But let me do a quick primer and sort of a summary of the basic argument that we're going to see Berkeley create. Now, first off, I mentioned British empiricism and idealism. So yeah, we have to recognize that he's really beginning with the position of John Locke. So he's beginning from an empiricist position, and then essentially critiquing that position, thereby reducing John Locke's philosophy or a version of his philosophy into an argument for the notion of metaphysical idealism. And this would ultimately mean epistemological idealism as well. Now, this, as I already mentioned, the key epistemological metaphysical principle is to be perceived. Now, so let me lay out four sort of things, and then we'll sort of jump to it sort of quickly. Sorry for the spelling errors again. There's no spell check on my software here. The first thing is he's against the doctrine of abstract ideas, and we're going to go through a number of the passages, a number of arguments he makes. But let me begin by just sort of making sure that you have the general gist of what Berkeley's arguing. John Locke had a view, right? Again, we already mentioned it, reviewed it, is that we have these perceptions and then we have these ideas, and that slowly we develop these abstract ideas, and that these abstract ideas ultimately represent or relate to the world, right? And so we're going to see that Berkeley strongly attacks this notion of abstract ideas, right? He's not against the notion that we have ideas, and he's not against the notion that we can abstract, but he's against the notion that abstract ideas form the basis upon knowledge. And he's going to argue a number of reasons why this is the case. One of them is simply the case that he doesn't think that abstract ideas are really ideas. Because think about it like this. If I ask you to imagine what a dog looks like, to come up with an abstract idea of what a dog is, right, you would eventually come up with a picture of a dog in your mind. But notice that that's not what an abstract idea of a dog should be, right? Because you would come up with a picture, an image, right? And that's what an idea is. It's an image in the mind that relates to our experience. You would come up with an image that's always particular, never abstract. So it looks like we can abstract from our ideas, but the abstract ideas are not strictly speaking ideas. It's not comprehensible. And we're going to see that this leads ultimately to Berkeley's critique of Locke's distinction between primary and the secondary qualities of the perception of an object. So for instance, remember when I hold something up, so here's my cup, and there's a drink in there, right? The cup itself has both primary and secondary qualities, according to Locke. The primary qualities are the extension it has in space. One of the primary qualities is the extension it has in space. One of the secondary qualities is the color. It's a blue, kind of greenish cup, right? But the fact that it has solidity, for instance, seems to be an essential or primary quality of the perception of this particular object. In other words, so that suggested to Locke that solidity or extension in space, things of this nature, are qualities that must actually adhere in the objects we perceive. Whereas the secondary qualities like color, smell, taste, are generally speaking of those things, seem to be secondary. In other words, they seem to be seated in our subjective experience rather than in the object itself. But we're going to see that, remember, primary and secondary qualities, this is itself an abstract idea. So with the critique of against the doctrine of abstract ideas, we're going to see that means that if Berkeley's right, that the distinction between primary and secondary qualities no longer holds. And this means that, okay, what exactly are we experiencing? And we'll see, strictly speaking, right? So Locke's view is that when you experience the cup, you're experiencing abstract qualities and your mind is combining them together into sort of a composite whole and all of this sort of stuff. Berkeley's notion is, no, when you see a green cup, what you're seeing, what you're experiencing is a green cup. Not a little bit of green, a little bit of cup that gets put together, but you're experiencing the same, you're experiencing a single idea, right? That's what it would mean to disregard the primary secondary distinction. Now, this ultimately means that this ultimately is combined with or in related to Berkeley's rejection of corporeal matter. So he thinks that in our experience, we can never really know what's outside of our mind. So why suppose there's something on the outside, as it were, right? So that means that my body, for instance, is actually given to me as an idea in my experience, right? And he says that's all it needs to be. There doesn't have to be some sort of matter on the other side. And that doesn't negate the reality of things because of the principle to be is to be perceived. When you perceive the green cup, or when I perceive my hands, that means they exist. They exist as ideas, but guess what? That's all existence is. Given that, right, you can see he's an anti-materialist, obviously. He rejects corporeal matter, but he also enacts what I would say is an epistemological simplification of British empiricism. The problem, though, is if you have these ideas, where do they exist, as it were, and how is it that they're coordinated, right? Because his notion here would be that all of these ideas are related to each other, but how exactly? Because if there's no material substance, then there can be no material causality. His answer is going to be, well, there can be that God is the answer, because God is everywhere, and since God perceives all things exist insofar as God continues to perceive them. So God plays the role of a guarantor. So we see it's interesting. You can see there's an affinity here with Descartes' philosophy. But you can see, if you recall our video on Descartes, we sort of said Descartes trying to go from point A to point 6, right? From the mind to the world. He gets there. We'll see that Berkeley says that there's mind, world, but he never goes any further. But God still plays the role of guarantor. And we'll see clear that we have to also say in defense here is that Berkeley is not anti-science, because many people might conclude, well, he's an idealist. He doesn't think there's a material world, and science is studying the material world, so it must be against science. And that's actually false, right? His view is that what does science actually study? Science doesn't study matter, because matter is unknown to us. Even John Locke argues that. So what does science study? It studies the relationship of the ideas that are given in perception as existing. And ultimately, science studies the way in which God guarantees the ordering and the structure of those ideas. And so science can gain knowledge, but it's not gaining knowledge about some corporeal matter that's inaccessible. It's rather gaining knowledge about the inherent relation, I put it this way, the natural relation that our ideas have with each other. Right, so that's sort of what the general gist is of Berkeley's idealism. So what I want to do now is I want to turn to the text directly. And I have to apologize. I didn't have I took a picture. What I do, as you've seen before, is I sort of go through the text and highlight key passages that I want us to walk through. And I did that, but the quality of this is not very good. So I apologize for that. But I think you should be able to read it. Let's see here. Oh, whoa, okay. It's going to take a little bit of getting used to. Okay, so let's take a look here. Make it a little bit bigger. Okay, and again, we're pulling this from the Principles of Human Knowledge, which is reprinted from a book by the same name from Oxford University Press. So if you want to get the original text, you can. And again, there's lots more to Berkeley's text, and he's actually quite a good writer, so I think you'll enjoy it. One thing I should say, for those of you who are young who are watching this, Berkeley wrote this when he was actually quite young, so there's hope for all of us. I don't mean that negatively, right? So he wrote this when he was quite young, in fact. One thing I didn't mention to you about Berkeley is I believe that when Berkeley died, he donated his entire library to Yale University and actually helped build their library. So I think he's one of the first donors to Yale University. So if you're watching this and you're at Yale, go to the library. Okay. So there's a couple of things we'll mention, and I'm just going to sort of walk through and just talk about some of these highlighted passages here. The first thing, of course, is he starts off. Clearly, he's talking about the principles of human knowledge. So the first thing is to recognize that we're within the domain of epistemology here. And the first sort of question is to ask, well, why is it that we should pursue questions of epistemology? Why should we try to figure out what the principles of human knowledge are? And what exactly is the role of philosophy? And in this first passage, I think he says it quite well, right? He says, philosophy being nothing else but the study of wisdom and truth, it may with reason be expected that those who have spent Those who have spent the most time and pains in it should enjoy a greater calm and serenity of mind, a greater clearness and evidence of knowledge, and be less disturbed with the doubts and difficulties than other men. So the first sort of thing is, he says, why are we doing this? One is because philosophy, gaining a clearer sense of what can be known and gaining a clearer sense of what we do know, ultimately gives us, is a sort of therapy. And it gives us a sort of, I don't know if happiness is the term, but it gives us peace, it seems to be what he's saying, right? And one of the things he says, you know, when, and I'll keep reading here, he says, yet so it is we see the illiterate bulk of mankind that walk the high road of plain common sense and are governed by the dictates of nature, for the most part easy and undisturbed. To them, nothing that's familiar appears unaccountable or difficult to comprehend, right? So you can see here, Berkeley begins by contrasting the philosopher is worried, and they have these problems that are raised by difficulties that are raised by other people intellectually, and they want to gain knowledge into them. And he says that sort of spirit of inquiry is very different from what the massive human beings do. And I don't know if this is really true, but this is his contention, at least especially in his day, is that most human beings are illiterate, maybe in his case, in this day and age, literally, today we might say figuratively, but most people do think that, for instance, philosophy is a waste of time, and that you can just live by common sense. Everything appears obvious, and nothing is difficult to understand. And we're going to see that Berkeley, and he thinks, and I think he's right, is that from a philosophical perspective, that seems to be quite wrong. Or at least for the philosopher, that's certainly not true. Right? He says, prejudices and errors of sense do from all parts discover themselves to our view, and endeavoring to correct these by reason, we are insensibly drawn into uncouth paradoxes, difficulties, and inconsistencies which multiply and grow upon us as we advance in speculation, till at length, having wandered through many intricate mazes, we find ourselves just where we were, or, which is worse, sit down in a forlorn skepticism. So what he's saying there is that ultimately, unless we can find a way to resolve these difficulties, we're forced into a type of skepticism in which it doesn't look like knowledge is possible. So notice there that it's very similar to what Descartes's doing. Descartes begins with sort of a similar question, right? Given that all of these different things are changing, what can really be known? And so I think what we're seeing is all of these philosophers, from Locke to Descartes to Leibniz and so on and so forth, all of them, you see philosophy is a sort of struggling against the wind, trying to understand. And most people don't care to understand. And so there's a certain interesting loneliness that I think comes with philosophy, right? But it's an important sort of venture that one ought to pursue, right? At the end here, in section two here, he also differentiates the notion of the finite and the infinite, which we've discussed at length already, right? Since human beings are finite, we don't have the ability to comprehend the infinite. So that's an epistemological point that's important to recognize, is that there's a basic limit to what can be understood inherently. And whatever can be understood, it can only be finite, as it were, right? So moving on, right? Then he goes on to argue that it's a hard thing to suppose that right deductions from true premises should ever end in consequences which cannot be maintained or made consistent, right? So here we have a methodological point, and that is namely that the way to proceed in order to avoid skepticism is ultimately to move slowly and make deductions from true principles, and that we trust that those deductions will be consistent with each other over time. So we have a sort of emphasis here on the priority and the importance of consistency. Now, again, I'm not covering everything he talks about here because it's a lot. Only that which I think is really, you know, I guess my version or my reading of it for today. By the way, great little quote. He says, that we have first raised a dust and then complain we cannot see. Anyway, he's such a great writer. where he talks about God's providence and that sort of thing. So you can see there's an importance here about thinking about the methodology and the step-by-step approach that we have to take here. And what we're going to see is he's building up, essentially, a criticism against John Locke. Right. So what is Berkeley's purpose? He says, "My purpose, therefore, is to try, if I can, discover what these principles of human reasoning are, which have introduced all that doubtfulness and uncertainty, those absurdities and contradictions into several sects of philosophy," right? So what we want to do is we want to figure out which principles are causing the problems and which principles are the principles that will actually have the consistent, simplified solution we're seeking here, right? He says, "It is a work well deserving our pains to make a strict inquiry concerning the first principles of human knowledge." So you can see here that for Berkeley, he's interested in the question of first principles. Now, we can stop and remind ourselves, what is a principle? A principle is, think of a principle as the rule which guides a type of reasoning, right? Or it's the rule, or it's the essential thing which organizes how something is to be conceived and thought about, or how it's to exist, right? So example here is, the principle of non-contradiction, right? The principle of non-contradiction is you can never contradict yourselves and be reasonable, right? A contradiction is when you say something both is and is not at the same time. So if I say that we're reading philosophy and we're not reading philosophy at the same time and in the same way, that doesn't make any sense. So the principle is essentially a derived rule which is embedded in a certain form of reasoning. Now, Aristotle talks about principles. One of the things he says that I think is highly instructive here is that principles cannot be demonstrated. So you can't prove a principle. You can only derive a principle. Why can't you prove a principle? Take non-contradiction as an example. You can't prove that the principle of non-contradiction is a good principle because without it, proofs are not possible. Which means that if a proof is using the principle of non-contradiction, well, then because it's using it, it can't demonstrate it too, right? Because the demonstration is the use of it. So it's problematic. So that means that principles are derived through reason rather than, viewed through, right? They're derived through reason rather than observed or experienced in the world. I guess that's what I want to say, okay? So let's move on here. One of the things that Berkeley thinks is that the reason that John Locke is led astray and the reason that many philosophers are led astray is because they abuse or misuse language. Now, this is quite revolutionary, in fact, because today, the primary form, I don't know about the primary, but one of the major forms of philosophy that's practiced in the Western world, in particular in the United States and in Great Britain, is what we would call the philosophy of language. That really begins with this notion that the philosophical problems we encounter may or are a result of a misuse or abuse of language in some way. He says, "In order to prepare the mind of the reader for the easier conceiving what follows, it is proper to premise somewhat by way of introduction concerning the nature and abuse of language," right? And then clearly he jumps out, "Abstract ideas is an abuse of this." He says, "And it is the opinion that the mind hath the power of framing abstract ideas or notions of things," right? So first and foremost, this means that Berkeley does not think we can form abstract ideas. Again, we will see that that doesn't mean that we don't have ideas, and it doesn't mean that we can't have abstraction. But what it means is that abstract ideas or notions of things is incomprehensible. It doesn't make sense, right? And the key there is, see, it says notions of things. Essentially, we're going to see he just cuts off the of things. All we're left with here are notions in his view. Okay. Now, he says, okay, "It's agreed on all hands that the qualities or modes of things do never really exist, each of them apart by itself and separated from all others, but are mixed, as it were, and blended together, several in the same object," right? So the qualities and the modes of the things don't exist in isolation, right? Everything seems to be related to other things. That's the first sort of thing we can recognize here, right? So we have this notion that there's a mixed compound ideas and that the mind can resolve these into their simpler constituent parts, right? And it's, so far, this sounds very much like John Locke, right? He says, not that it is possible for color or motion to exist without extension, but only that the mind can frame to itself by extraction the idea of color exclusive of extension and of motion exclusive of color and extension. So let's take a pause here and let's see if I can explain that, right? So his notion here is that we don't have abstract ideas, but what we do have is abstractions. So what is an abstraction? So when I see the green, blue cup, or whatever color this thing is, right? It's not that I have a simple idea that gets combined into a complex idea and then develops into another, an even bigger abstract idea and so on and so forth. It's rather, he thinks that we have an idea, and from that idea we can, as it were, isolate certain things about it that have to be related to the other parts. So the color is related to the solidity in real life, that, right? It's here in one object, but then my mind is actually abstracting the idea of color exclusive of extension or excluded from the solidity of the cup and so on and so forth. So we have this notion that abstraction is possible, but he doesn't think that that means that this develops into an abstract idea, right? He discusses, for instance, motion. He says, by considering motion abstractedly, not only from the body moved, but likewise from the figure it describes and all particular directions and velocities, the abstract idea of motion is framed, right? So this is what it looks like abstract ideas are. We have this possibility of abstracting, and then in Locke's view, that's what an abstract idea is, ultimately, right? And so that means that the mind frames to itself abstract ideas, and it does through the same precision or mental separation that we attain abstract ideas of the more compounded beings and so forth. So he gives the example, John. He says, so for example, the mind, having observed that Peter, James, and John resemble each other, right, in certain common agreements of shape and other qualities, leaving out the complex or compound idea it has of Peter, James, and other particular men, that which is peculiar to each, retaining only what is common to all, and so makes an abstract idea wherein all the particulars equally partake. Abstracting entirely from the cutting off of all those circumstances and differences which might determine it to any particular existence. So you can see here, the notion here is that this abstract idea, you pull it out and it no longer is related to existence. That's going to be a very important feature of the problem. Let's see here if I can go next. Okay, here we go. I'm over here. As you can see, again, I apologize. I had to use my phone, so it's not exactly the best quality, right? Here, one over here. So let's keep going. He says, quote, moreover, there being a great variety of other creatures that partake in some parts but not all of the complex idea of man, the mind leaving out those parts which are peculiar to men and retaining those only which are common to all living creatures, frameth the idea of animal, which abstracts not only from all particular men, but also from birds, fishes, insects, and so on and so forth, right? So it looks like abstract ideas are the result of this sort of abstraction, right? Where by the word body, right, we mean something with a particular shape and figure. So think about it here. If you say I have an abstract idea of an animal, every animal must have a body, right? What do I mean by body? Well, in that definition, body doesn't refer to any concrete particular shape or figure. What does it refer to? And that therein lies the problem. I'm not sure it refers to anything, because even though I have a notion of animal, right, if I'm forced to give an image of what an animal is, I'm always forced to push it into this particularized shape of some sort. I'm going to imagine this or that animal. Okay, so he says that he finds, I'm sorry, this is hard to read. He says, I find indeed I have a faculty of imagining, of representing to myself the ideas of these particular things I have perceived and have variously compounded and divided. Whatever hand or eye I imagine, it must have some particular shape and color. Right? Every time we try to imagine one of these abstract ideas, we're actually forced to give a particular idea. Now, that doesn't make a lot of sense, actually, right? Because notice that Locke's view is that we have simple, and then from the simple, we have complex ideas, and then from complex ideas, we can develop these greater abstractions of ideas through reflection. Then we can use those abstract ideas and compound them and still get further abstract. But the problem is, at the root core is the notion that the idea should actually refer to something that's particularized in our experience, but that doesn't follow throughout these levels of abstraction, right? He goes on, the generality of men, which are simple and illiterate, never pretend to abstract notions. It's sad they're difficult and not to be attained without pains and study. So it's difficult to have abstract ideas. Let's keep going. He says, abstract general ideas is what puts the widest difference in point of understanding between man and beast. I highlighted this more because I'm interested in environmental ethics. And so it's abstract general ideas. We're going to see that he's against abstract ideas, but he's not necessarily against the notion of general ideas, right? The idea of having a general idea, like, for instance, I say he, right, for instance, is that which puts a perfect distinction between man and brutes, he thinks, right? So he thinks that the ability for human beings to do this seems to be the key difference. In fact, he seems to suggest that it's possible that animals may actually have reason to a certain extent, but they seem to lack this ability of abstraction, right? He says, therefore, I think we may suppose that it is in this that the species of brutes are discriminated from men or human beings, and 'tis that perfect difference wherein they are wholly separated and which at last widens to so wide a distance. For if they have any ideas at all and are not bare machines as some might have them, we cannot deny them to have some reason. It seems as evident to me that they do some of them in certain instances reason as they have sense. Now, but it is only in particular ideas just as they receive from their senses. And I thought this was quite instructive because I'm thinking about my cat, right? My cat, obviously, when I put a piece of food on the floor and it eats it or it cries for food or something like this, it's clear that the cat must have, it seems, or at least highly likely, that the cat must have some sort of idea of what, they have some sort of mental representation of what they're perceiving. But it doesn't, so in that sense, there's a sort of reasoning going on, but it doesn't seem to attain to an abstraction. So my cat never turns to me and my cat doesn't want food. It wants a particular thing to eat. That's the difference there. Food is the abstraction, but, you know, the meat on the floor is the real deal. And it looks like this is the difference between men and animals. And I think that's quite interesting. It seems to be a retreat from Descartes' insistence that animals are just essentially biological machines, which may play a role for thinking about ethics later. Anyway, that's my own thing. But the faculties of animals are such that they can't attain abstraction. So abstraction is not something they have. And we know this because they don't have language. Because what is language? Well, here we say that language is essentially when we have an idea and then we use a word or a sign to refer to that idea. Right, so that means that language is functionally an abstraction of type. It's a sort of abstraction itself. And animals do not have this. They do not speak. And so they must also lack this requisite capacity for abstraction. Right? He says that he thinks that eventually what we're going to acknowledge is that an idea, which is considered in itself as particular, becomes general by being made to represent or stand for all other particular ideas of the same sort. So that means that what is an abstraction here? An abstraction is when I have, my ideas are actually particularized to my experience. So when I think of the blue cloud, I'm thinking about this. But what I do is I can generalize, right, I can generalize by taking an idea and making that idea fit all possible cases of a particular type. And that's what generalization is. It's not that I've abstracted from something. I've rather just created a way, mentally, rationally, to represent all of these particulars under the accumulated head of one idea. That idea, in this case, is a word, cup, right? And so this is how he thinks ideas work. It's a very sort of different and less hierarchical sense for thinking about language. So in other words, what you can say is Berkeley distinguishes language from the ideas of our perception. Whereas it looks like John Locke thinks they're just built on top of each other, such that if John Locke was right, that means that arguments in language must in some way correspond to arguments regarding things in the world or something like this. And that doesn't seem to be the case, because that would then mean that it would be very difficult to understand what it means to be wrong about something and these sorts of issues. So he says, and as that particular line becomes general by being made a sign to the name line, which taken absolutely is particular by being a sign, is made general. So his notion here is we have ideas, and when we generalize them, we give that, that's when they go from being ideas to being words, right? Because a word is a sign. So that means that there would have to be two fundamental modes or parts to human reasoning. There is the sign-making part, the abstraction part, that then on these abstract ideas are really just general names we create to talk about all these things, but they're not actually corresponding to objects in the world as such. It's only the particular ideas that have existence. So that means that abstract ideas don't exist, strictly speaking, or at least they are abstract ideas of things in the world do not exist in the world as abstract ideas, right? So obviously abstract ideas exist in us, or this is why he wants to use the term general, right? General ideas do exist, but they exist as ideas in us. They don't exist in the world. And so you can see here, he even quotes an essay concerning human understanding, and he directly here is, of course, critical of John Locke's general thesis. And we'll see it's an interesting critique, but the consequences are is that that means that a lot of the things which we like that John Locke concludes with have to be rejected. Okay. Now, I'm just going through the highlighted points here, right? I like this one. It says, to emancipate our thoughts from particular objects and raise them to those sublime speculations that are conversant about abstract ideas. So what he wants to do is he wants us to he wants us to move beyond John Locke's simplicity here, and also to emancipate ourselves ultimately from it, right? So let's go here with 15. He says, nor do I think that wit more needful for the enlargement of knowledge than communication. It is, I know, a point most insistent on that all knowledge and demonstration are about universal notions, to which I fully agree, okay? So that means that what we're really concerned with is we're concerned with universal knowledge. So he's not denying that simply because there are no abstract ideas, but rather generalizations that are given as language, right? He doesn't think that means that universal knowledge is impossible. That doesn't mean we can't know things universally. I mean, it doesn't mean that demonstration can only be about particulars. So it is, in fact, possible to have demonstrable knowledge about universal things. He goes on. But then it does not appear to me that those notions are formed by abstraction in the manner premised. Universality, so far as I can comprehend, not consisting in the absolute positive nature of conception of thing, but in the relation it bears to the particulars signified or represented by it, right? So that means that he's not saying that when we abstract, when we talk about something being the case universally, so we say all human beings are mortal, they're going to die. So since all, and that's a universal claim, I'm saying all human beings. His notion here is that when I have that general abstract idea, that doesn't give me knowledge about what's really in the universe, right? What it does is it's really a movement of language in which I've given a name to cover all these different possible cases. And that name is ultimately signifies or represents particulars, but it doesn't in fact mean that there's something positively that exists. It's not a positive nature conception, right? It's merely a device, if you will. So you can see that means that what Berkeley's view here is that a proper view of language and the way in which language represents things will reveal that there is a limit to what we can say exists, that ultimately will be catastrophic for John Locke, as it were. He says, it seems therefore that to be certain, this proposition is universally true, we must either make a particular demonstration of every particular triangle, which is impossible, or once for all demonstrate it, of abstract idea of a triangle in which all particulars do indifferently partake and by which they're all equally represented. He says, to which I answer that though the idea I have in view whilst I make the demonstration be, for instance, that of an isosceles rectangular triangle, whose sides are of a determinate length, I may nevertheless be certain it extends to all rectangular triangles of what sort or bigness soever, and that because neither the right angle nor the equality nor determinate length of the sides are at all concerned in the demonstration, it's true that the diagram I have in view includes all those particulars, but then there is not the least mention made of them in the proof of the proposition. It's not said that the three angles are equal to two right ones, because one of them is a right angle, or because the sides comprehending it are of the same length, which sufficiently shows that the right angle might have been oblique and the sides unequal, and for all the demonstration have held good. And for this reason it is that I conclude that to be true of any oblique angular or a scalion, which I've demonstrated a particular right angle equicurial triangle, and not because I've demonstrated the proposition of an abstract idea of a triangle. Now, I've read through that, and you can see he's giving the example here of what happens when we make a universal claim in geometry, for instance. What happens is we use words like triangle, which are generalized, but they're not abstract ideas that refer to things. But it's through the deduction of relationships that I'm able to deduce the universality of the triangle here, not by the abstract idea. It's not that I just have to get the idea of an abstract idea in my head and describe it. Not at all. Rather, I have to deduce the relationships within the particular to show that they are necessary and thereby universal to all like triangles. I've probably completely confused you, but it should make sense, right? Okay, let me take a little drink here. He says, it were an endless as well as a useless thing to trace the schoolmen, those great masters of abstraction, through all the manifold, inextricable labyrinths of error and dispute. Okay, the schoolmen refer to the medieval philosophers. So here he's attacking medieval philosophy. So he's not just against Descartes. He critiques Descartes, but he's not just critiquing Locke, but he's also critiquing really the entire philosophical history that comes before him. And this, his argument about abstraction here would also apply to Plato, right? Plato, though we haven't covered Plato in this course, if you're interested, take a look at my video series on ancient philosophy in which I talk about Plato. But for Plato, triangle is an abstract idea that has reality. And so that's exactly the opposite view that Berkeley has here. Now, I should say there are some interesting intricacies, because for Plato, the idea is not something in the world at all. So Plato is still, I think, he doesn't directly attack Plato here, but there is an implicit critique, I think. Now, okay, he says that I now need to consider the source of the prevailing notion. And that seems to me to be language, okay? So we've been talking about language, and though we didn't really read through it, we did talk a little bit in Locke's discussion of language, but Locke has a long sort of analysis of abstract ideas and their relationship to language and so forth, right? So I'm gonna sort of go through this, but essentially what Berkeley's doing here is he's drawing our attention back to John Locke. And he says, let's examine the manner wherein words have contributed to the origin of this mistake. The mistaken language. Now it says, where in truth there is no such thing as one precise and definite signification that's annexed to any general name, they all signify indifferently a great number of particular ideas, right? So let me say that again. It says, there's no such thing as one precise definite signification that gets annexed to a general name, right? It's not like there's one perfect shape of what a horse is for the general name of a horse, right? Horse refers to a whole bunch of different, a plurality of different objects. But whenever horse is used, it always, in experience, it always has to correspond to that particular. Okay, so let's go up here now. There is no one settled idea which limits the signification of the word triangle, right? And if there were abstract ideas, then once we had the abstract idea, we would only need the abstract idea to understand what it meant. So the word triangle, if it's an abstract idea, as Locke suggests, then just understanding what triangle is should be enough to understand what the word means. But clearly that isn't the case, because people can make mistakes about triangles in terms of what they think a triangle is about, and so on and so forth. He says, to one thing for to keep a name constantly to the same definition, another to make some stand everywhere for the same idea, the one is necessary, the other is useless and impractical, right? So it's not like the notion the word triangle stands for every triangle, right? It's rather simply that it stands everywhere for the same idea. So words come to produce the doctrine of abstract ideas. Or in other words, what seems to happen is that we're using these words, and it looks like there's a movement of equivocation, I think, in which we begin to treat the words as the ideas themselves, right? He goes on in section 20, right? He says, besides, the communicating of ideas marked by words is not the chief and only end of language, as it's commonly supposed. He says there are other ends, such as raising some passion, the exciting to, or deterring from an action, the putting the mind in some particular disposition. There's lots and lots of uses for language that are not simply related to the representation of ideas. Think about humor here. If Locke's theory is that our ideas ultimately we have abstract ideas, and that those ultimately correspond to the way our experience is represented in perception. If that's the truth, then think about something like humor. When someone tells a joke, and they're using abstract ideas, obviously they're not trying to represent things, right? They're using their words in a different way. So you have to realize here is that that philosophy is one mode of language. It's not the only mode of language. And it looks like that what Locke has done, I think, from Berkeley's perspective, is that he's recognized the necessity of language and for his epistemology, but then he's gone on to go further and reduce language to just being sufficiently an epistemological element in our experience. And that seems to be problematic, right? So he says, I entreat the reader to reflect with himself, or herself in this case, and see if it doth not often happen either in hearing or reading a discourse that the passions of fear, love, hate, admiration, disdain, and the like arise immediately in the mind upon the perception of certain words without any ideas coming between them. Right? Think about it. When we go to a play and we see a moving piece and we start weeping, a moving monologue, and we start weeping or crying, think about that use of language there. Do we need abstract ideas in order to understand those things? Is that the function of language there? He says, the hearing of the sounds or sight of the characters is often immediately attended with these passions, right? It looks like the language symbolizes for us, in some cases, general terms, and in other cases, particular ideas, and that it's that symbolization which moves us, not the words, right? So, but words can move us. So words have a, because through a representational sort of mode, words can move us, but they can move us in a whole bunch of different ways. He says, even proper names themselves do not seem always spoken with a design to bring into our view the ideas of those individuals that are supposed to be marked by them. For instance, Aquinas often says, Aristotle hath said, right? And think of the way in which we use names to mark things out. He says on 21, we have, I think, shown the impossibility of abstract ideas, and we've considered what has been said for them by their ablest patrons, endeavor to show they are of no use for our ends, to which they are thought necessary. And lastly, we have traced them to their source from whence they flow, which appears to be language. So that means that abstract ideas are actually generated through linguistic mechanisms, not generated through a perception we have of the world, which means that we can't just, it means that when means there's a limit to the British empiricist mode that John Locke is committed to, and in this abstract idea of business is ultimately at the very core of, I think, what Berkeley thinks goes wrong for him. So what we're discussing here with abstract ideas ultimately consists of Berkeley's critique, I think. Okay, so he says, first, we have to get clear of all controversies that are purely verbal. Secondly, when it comes to language, this seems to be a sure way to extricate myself out of that fine and subtle net of abstract ideas, which is so miserably perplexed and entangled the minds of men, right? So I think, thirdly, so long as I confine my thoughts to my own ideas divested of words, I don't see how I can easily be mistaken. So this means that he thinks that through deduction, right, we can get clear of, well, let's start with the first point. The first point here is that means that problems that arise out of language are not real philosophical problems. They're verbal problems. So we don't have to try to address controversies which are purely verbal, which means that Berkeley doesn't have to try to deal with the controversies that arise according to John Locke, right? Because of the doctrine of abstract ideas, he's generated these verbal problems. Now that we've gotten rid of the notion of abstract ideas, that means that we should be able to follow through in our deduction methodically without going astray, right? So that means that, you know, like all great philosophers, first you start off by kicking the last philosopher, and next you start off laying out why your view must be the right view. So it's sort of methodological certainty here, right? He says, so long as men thought abstract ideas were annexed to their words, that is, the abstract ideas are automatically related to their words, it does not seem strange that they should use words for ideas, it being found an impractical thing to lay aside the word and retain the abstract idea of the mind, which in itself is actually inconceivable. So that means that that's the sort of phrase and the point at which the text where he really seems to argue that, listen, abstract ideas are actually just incomprehensible, because an abstract idea should, if it's an idea, you should be able to come up with the sensual perceptions that go along with it, and you can't do it. You can only come up with a particular, right? He says, he that knows he has no other particular ideas won't puzzle himself in vain to find out and conceive an abstract idea that's been annexed to a name, right? So it's not that it's not like if I'm puzzled or confused, I'm just trying to combine what the sensible experience that must somehow relate to this idea. We don't do that. He says, and he that knows names do not always stand for ideas will spare himself the labor of looking for ideas where there are none to be had. So it's really important here to recognize there's a difference here between names and ideas. And it looks like, from Berkeley's perspective, names do not have existential content. That is, names themselves do not relay existence or the status of the existence of a thing. So just because I have the concept of triangle doesn't mean there really are triangles. So the abstract ideas, so we get rid of that notion. And that means that when we talk about ideas, we have to be talking about particularized and, I think, concrete forms of sensible experience. So I do have an idea of this or that cup, but I don't have an abstract idea of cupness, but I do have a name, which is a generalization of all the ideas I do have of cups. Hopefully that makes sense. Okay. So he says, but the reason we're doing this is because, quote, unless we take care to clear the first principles of knowledge from the embargoes and delusion of words, we may make infinite reasoning upon them to no purpose. We may draw consequences from consequences, but never be any wiser. So I think it's a great sort of phrase here. The importance here is that once we get clear of language, we can now start to do the investigation. So you can see the first introduction here, the argument against abstract ideas, is really just laying out his sort of epistemological points and laying out the limits for what he's willing to concede in terms of his metaphysics or epistemology. Okay, let's take a look here. Let me make that a little smaller. Okay, let me make it a little bigger now. Sometimes this thing doesn't like to work well. There we go. Let me zoom this. Okay. Let me just read this, right? This is the very beginning of section one. He says, it's evident to anyone who takes a survey on the objects of human knowledge that there are either ideas actually imprinted in the senses, or else such as are perceived by attending to the passions and operations of the mind, or lastly, the ideas formed by help of memory and imagination, either compounding or dividing or barely representing those originally perceived in the aforesaid way. So there's a different, so we can see here that it looks like ideas are either imprinted on the senses in this tabula rasa, or they're perceived by attending to the mind, or they come about by forming our imagination and our memory and combining things together, like horse in a horn, and then I get a unicorn and so forth. So, and by the way, Descartes kind of says the exact same thing here in the second meditation. Okay, so that means that there. So where do ideas come from? Well, they come from these three different sources. It looks like, right? They're imprinted through experience. So in this case, using Descartes' lens, they're adventitious. They're created by the mind. They're created by me, or they're gained through sort of reasoning. Okay, he says there's likewise something which knows or perceives them and exercises diverse operations. So we know there's ideas, but not only is there ideas, there has to also be the thing which perceives the ideas. So you have the mental events, but you must also have a mind. So that's where we get those two sort of basic components here. Now, this perceiving act of being is what he calls mind, spirit, soul, or myself, right? By which words I do not denote any of my ideas, but a thing entirely distinct from them, wherein they exist, or which is the same thing whereby they're perceived, okay? So we have the ideas, and we have the thing which recognizes or perceives the ideas, okay? You have the object and the subject, essentially. Okay? And he says, and to me, it seems no less evident that the various sensations or ideas imprinted on the sense, however blended or combined together, cannot exist other than in the mind that's perceiving them. So where do our ideas of things exist? His answer here is that they exist in the mind. Notice, he's not saying they exist in the world and they're represented by the mind. That's not his claim. His claim is that they exist in the mind. That is, when you perceive something and you have an idea of it in your head, you are perceiving it directly. Remember, with John Locke, we had a notion that all of our experience of the world is only indirect, right? This is not the case here. Because our ideas exist in the mind, we therefore have a direct access to them. This solves a whole bunch of problems. And by the way, and this is also a consequence of there not being abstraction. If you have abstract ideas, you can maintain this sort of indirectness. That is, if abstract ideas are comprehensible, right? He goes on, he says, I think an intuitive knowledge may be obtained by this, by anyone that shall attend to what is meant by the term exist, which applied to some things, right? He says, the table I write on, I say exist, that is, I see it, I feel it. And if I were out of my study, I should say it existed, meaning thereby that if I was in my study, I might perceive it, or someone else will perceive it. So think about it. When I say that something exists, what am I talking about exactly? Think of your car, if you have a car. I have a car. I have a car, and when I'm in it, it exists. How do I know it exists? Because I can touch it, and I can feel it, and I can hold it. And when I walk away, and I say, does it exist? If I think it does exist, then it means that if I go back, I'm able to touch and feel that thing. But imagine, what happens if, imagine this case. Imagine that I park my car and I go to work. And when I park my car, I can touch it, I feel it, I know it exists. What happens when I go home, when I go to work? I can no longer touch or feel it. Then the question is, do I know it exists? Now, most of the time we say, yeah, it exists. Even though I'm not perceiving it, because when I go back to it, it's still there. But what happens? What if I'm at work one day, and while I'm working, someone steals my car, takes it to a chop shop, they cut it all apart. By the time 5 o'clock rolls around, I come outside, my car is gone, but my car doesn't even exist in the world at all. It's gone, gone. Under that condition, how do I know it's gone? Well, I know it's gone because it would become impossible for me to ever perceive it through my five senses ever again. right? So that means that existence is always confirmed through perception. So wherever something exists, you have perception, and wherever you have perception, you must have something that exists. He says their esse is their percipi. That is, their essence is their perception. To be is to be perceived. You're going to see his esse as percipi here, right? He says, is it not plainly repugnant that any one of these or any combination of them should exist unperceived? Right? Imagine if I told you that imagine if I walked into your house and I said, guess what? I've got $1 million for you. And you're like, oh, great. Where is it? I say, it's right here in this suitcase. Unfortunately, you'll never be able to perceive it. So it's $1 million. It's just invisible to all of your senses. So I hope you're happy. Well, would you be happy? Obviously not, because if an unperceived $1 million is in principle not $1 million, right? It looks like perception is this absolute central ingredient here when we talk about existence, okay? Now notice this is a very, John Locke also is concerned with existence too, but he has this model of the mind and indirect knowledge, etc., which pushes the question of existence into an indirect relation. But that's because he has his theory of matter. We see here, Berkeley is using some of the same ideas, but in a different way, since he's negated abstract ideas, to talk about existence as being something that's imminent to the mind, right? So you exist, and while you're perceiving, the thing you're perceiving exists, right? He says, later, it is impossible for me to see or feel anything without an actual sensation of the thing. So it's impossible for me to conceive in my thoughts any sensible thing or object distinct from the sensation or perception of it. Right, their being, their esse is to be perceived or known. I'm sorry, that's not essence. I think I said that earlier. Consequently, and I've started, so I'll read it. Consequently, so long as these ideas are not actually perceived by me, or do not exist in my mind, or that of any other created spirit, they must either have no existence, or else subsist in the mind of some internal spirit, it being perfectly unintelligible and involving all the absurdity of abstraction to attribute to any single part of them an existence independent of spirit, right? So get rid of the abstract ideas here. And then the question is, anything that exists has to be perceived while it's existing. Since that's the case, if I am not perceiving something and something continues to exist, there must be something else which is perceiving it. And you can see here he says some eternal spirit. His notion here is that God is continually perceiving all these things. So you don't need a theory that there's matter in the world, that everything is made up of something you can't experience, that's corporeal. That's not what existence is. Existence is the perception of the idea given directly to us in the mind. And that means that the world exists means that there must be a world perceiver. There must be a being which is perceiving all of this, this existence, okay? He says, so from what follows, there is not any other substance than spirit or that which perceives. So for him, this is where we get the idealism, is this would mean metaphysically that since existence is related to perception, and perception is an idea, this means that matter is completely gone, right? Existence is not in some sort of substance. It's not in something, some sort of matter. It's not some sort of stuff that we can't quite get to. Rather, existence is purely ideas. So ideas are, that all we have are ideas. Reality is fundamentally a form of ideation. Right, he says here in the blue, now for any idea to exist in an unperceiving thing, it's a manifest contradiction, right? We've already mentioned that. You can't, something can't exist where it can't be perceived, right? That is a contradiction ultimately. So there's no unthinking substance or substrate for these ideas. He says, though the ideas themselves do not exist without the mind, yet there may be things like them whereof they are copies or resemblance of, which things exist without mind in an unthinking substance, I answer that an idea can be like nothing but an idea. A color or figure can be nothing like but another color or a figure, right? So what he's arguing here essentially is that It's not through saying that, oh, well, these things exist somewhere else, and slowly it's creating some sort of speculative answer to explain why a color is a color or an idea is like an idea. He says an idea is an idea, and a color is exactly what we experience it to be. This is, again, a consequence of the to be is to be perceived formula. Right now, this is the passage where we start to see Berkeley attack the notion of secondary and primary qualities. He says there's some, obviously he's talking about Locke, who make the distinction between primary and secondary qualities. By the former, they mean extension, figure, motion, rest, solidity, or impenetrability and number. Almost a quote, almost directly quoted. And he says, by the latter, they denote other sensible qualities like color, sounds, taste, and so forth. Right? Now, what he's going to say here is, because of this, this means that when we have an idea of something, well, first off, let me put it through this. First off, a primary and secondary qualities are ultimately forms of abstract ideas. They're abstractions from something. So when I see the cup, we've already talked about it. For Berkeley, I just have the idea and I can generalize from that idea using words. But for Locke, right, he says when you look at the cup, you can abstract the extension and figure from the color and the smell or whatever. And then that abstraction reveals something about the existence of the cup itself, namely that the primary qualities are real and the secondary ones are not. And this is where Berkeley, you can see, is in clear contradiction or in conflict with John Locke. He says, by matter, therefore, we're to understand an inert, senseless substance in which the extension, figure, and motion somehow actually exist, but in a way which cannot in principle be perceived, right? He says, but it's evident that what we've shown here is that extension, figure, and all of these things, right? Let me read it. Figure and motion are only ideas existing in the mind, right? They're abstractions. And that an idea can be nothing but another idea. And that consequently, neither they nor their archetypes can exist in an unperceiving substance. So in other words, they don't exist in matter. Whoops. Okay. This one looks almost impossible to read. Let's see here. We're almost done here. He says, I desire anyone to reflect and try whether they can, for any abstraction of thought, conceive the extension and motion of a body without all the other sensible qualities. Right? He says, can you imagine what it's like to have color by itself without anything else? Pure color. And the answer is no, because I can only imagine things which are colored, objects which are colored, particularized cases of ideas, right? And he says, here I cannot but remark how nearly the vague and indeterminate description of matter or corporeal substance which the modern philosophers are run into their own principles resembles the antiquated and so much ridiculed notion of materia prima, which is what Aristotle argues. Aristotle has this notion of prime matter, and I won't go into it, but prime matter it has a similar problem here, actually. And the modern philosophers are easy to criticize Aristotle, but it looks like John Locke, for his part, is committing the same contradiction. Okay, let me move over. I can't really read that one too well. Right. He says up here, he says, it's strange to think how anyone should give it an absolute existence without the mind, right? It seems very odd to do so. So that means that when we're experiencing, let me read this. He says, I shall further add that when the same manner as modern philosophers prove certain sensible qualities to have no existence in matter or without the mind, the same thing may be likewise proved of all other sensible qualities whatsoever. Thus, for instance, it's said that hot and cold, are affections only of the mind and not at all patterns of real beings existing in corporeal substances which excite them, right? The notion there is that the notion of hot or cold is a subjective appropriation of an experience. It's not something isn't really hot in itself. He says, for that the same body which appears cold to one hand seems warm to another, right? So now why may we not as well argue that figure and extension are not patterns or resemblances of qualities existing in matter? Because to the same eye at different stations, or eyes of different texture of the same station, they appear various, and therefore cannot be images of anything settled and determinate without the mind. Basically what he's saying here is that when John Locke says that the secondary quality exists in the mind rather than in the object, such as color, right? He says, why couldn't I just say the same thing about extension and figure, right? It seems that really you can say the same thing. And because notice here, what he's ultimately arguing is that there is no difference between primary and secondary qualities of perception. All we have are just the qualities of the ideas we have in perception. Okay, he says, in short, let anyone consider those arguments which are thought manifestly to prove that colors and taste exist only in the mind, and he shall, and they may with equal force be brought to prove the same thing about extension, figure, and motion. The arguments foregoing plainly show it's impossible that any color or extension at all should exist in an unthinking subject. So what we see here is finally the formal denial of external matter. What we have here is that the source of our problem is the abstract idea of matter. So matter is a generalization, but in Locke, it becomes an abstract idea, which is supposed to denote reality. And that is the mistake. Wherever their matter ultimately refers to being, right? Because when we say that something has matter, we're really saying it just exists. But when we're saying it exists, what are we saying? We're really saying that it is being perceived or can be perceived. And that's really the extent of what we actually mean, right? He says, but though it were possible that solid, figured, movable substances may exist without the mind, corresponding to the ideas we have of bodies, yet how is it possible for us to know this, right? How is it we can know of the externality of being, right? It looks like knowledge of existence always requires the mind, and that we can have ideas without bodies. We can have ideas of things, and the idea itself is not dependent upon this abstract idea that there are body that exists somehow corporeally separate. That doesn't make any sense, and it's not consistent, right? So this means that ultimately we're left with the form of idealism, and we've rejected primary and secondary qualities, and at the core is this problem of abstract ideas. Okay, let's see. I'm going to move to the next one. We're almost done here. He says, in short, if there were external bodies, it would be impossible that we would ever even know it. And if there were not, we might have the very same reasons to think that there were that we have now. So all things being equal, there doesn't seem to be a very good reason to suppose that there are external bodies or that there's corporeal matter. Instead, we should just eliminate the category. Because remember, the key here is we're talking about what can be known. He's talking about the principles of human knowledge. And the principles seem to show us that we can't know that there are external bodies. So that means that maybe I don't need a body. Maybe Descartes' problem of how do I know that this is a real hand? Maybe that, who cares? It doesn't matter, because whether there is or not, we're going to have the same situation, at least with regards to the epistemological framework that Berkeley's setting out here, right? So how is it that we do gain knowledge? The answer is we gain knowledge through demonstration and reason. We do gain knowledge of the world by taking our ideas and then our ideas and our concepts in our language even, and using deduction, right? So we can use reason to learn about these things. We don't have to learn about the bodies to learn about the ideas, right? But you say, right? So if you don't like this, he's like, you're going to say, surely there is nothing easier than to imagine trees, for instance, in a park, or books existing in a closet, and nobody by to perceive them, right? So we can easily imagine cases in which there's no one watching the car. There's no one out there perceiving it. Does it really exist? And as you know, he's going to argue that, well, it does exist because it's subject to the perception of some being, eternal being, God, right? He says, it only shows that you have the power of imagining or forming ideas in your mind, but it doesn't show that you can conceive it possible, that you conceive it possible that objects of your thought may exist without your mind. So even though I can imagine myself not being there to perceive the car, right, the act of imagination here doesn't deny or cause me to deny that the mind is still a requirement for existence, right? He says, but the mind taking no notice of itself is deluded to think that it can conceive bodies existing unthought of or without the mind, right? So we have the ability through our imagination to imagine these cases, but strictly speaking, it doesn't make any sense to say that was the case, right? He goes on, I insist to wit that the absolute existence of unthinking things are words without a meaning, of which include a contradiction. And this is what I repeat and indicate and earnestly recommend to the attentive thoughts of the reader. All of our ideas, sensations, or the things which we perceive, by whatever names they may be distinguished, are visibly inactive. There's nothing of power or agency included in them, so that one idea or object of thought cannot produce or make any alteration in another. So we have to recognize here is that when we're talking about ideas here, ideas are what we perceive, but the perception of them doesn't change, there isn't related to each other. Right, this is the notion that ultimately our ideas are not causally related, it doesn't look like here. You notice here Leibniz is sort of coming back in. And in a certain way, you can think of Berkeley here as almost describing a sort of idealistic monadology, though he doesn't say that to be strict, right? But it doesn't look like there's anything contained in the ideas that's an unthinking substance, right? There's no bodies that we have to associate with them, no matter they have to be associated with. So how is it that these things all relate to each other? Because, for instance, when I drink my glass, or not my glass, when I drink the drink in my glass, I feel that it's cold, right? And I feel there's a relationship between the ice and the drink and all of this. But you can see here, how are these things being related if not through these bodies, right? He says, we perceive a continual succession of ideas. Some are newly excited, some are changed, and some totally disappear. So we're constantly getting this flow of these ideas. And so he thinks that what we think is, well, it has to be some sort of substance, right? It has to be shown that there's no, it must therefore be a substance, but it has been shown that there is no corporeal material substance. So it remains therefore that the cause of ideas is in an incorporeal substance, active substance or spirit. There must be something actively that's relating these ideas together. And the answer, of course, is going to be that there's God and there's us, right? He says the spirit is one simple, undivided, active being. So there has to be an active cause to it. A spirit is one type, and it's called the understanding, and it produces or otherwise operates about them, and this is called the will. So he's thinking here about the way the mind relates to these ideas. Remember, he says, we have the mental events and we have the mind which acts on those mental events. Quote, hence there could be no formed idea of a soul or spirit, for all ideas, whatever, being passive and inert, they cannot represent unto us by way of an image or likeness that which acts. A little attention will make it plain to anyone that to have an idea which shall be like that active principle of motion and change of ideas is absolutely impossible. Right? He goes on. He then goes on to argue that we also have to recognize that the ideas we perceive are not voluntary, right? We can't, through a sheer will, determine what ideas we're perceiving. So even though there's no material world that exists for Berkeley, it doesn't mean that I can choose how my ideas are. I can't just look at my cup and make it levitate, for instance. Even though I'm trying, it doesn't respond, right? The cup still sits there and I'm still perceiving in the same way. So you can see here that that must mean that the mind can relate to ideas, but in this case, because my perceptions and the ideas I perceive are not voluntary, there has to be something else which is an active spirit which does control them, as it were. And there is therefore some other spirit that produces these. And his answer here is that they're related to God. And you can see this difference here. The ideas that I do have control over are ultimately the result of my imagination where I combine things together. But whatever I imagine in my mind, the ideas, so if I imagine a type of animal, a monster, we'll call it a jigamaru. If I imagine a jigamaru, I've created that in my imagination. But that's very different from seeing something that would be a jigamaru, or very different from seeing the cup, where the cup seems to have a veracity in perception that's very different than that of imagination. So we can distinguish the difference between ideas that are just merely in us from the ideas We can distinguish the ideas which are the result of our imagination and are merely in us from the ideas that are in us, that are perceived by us, but are independent of us, and for whom which we are not the active agents. So this gives a sort of foresight, he says, quote, which enables us to regulate our actions for the benefit of life. And without this, we would be eternally at a loss, right? So it's absolutely necessary that the world is not like that. Because this establishes, I think, the objectivity of the things we're experiencing in the world. He goes on, and yet this consistent uniform working, which so evidently displays the goodness and wisdom of that governing spirit, whose will constitutes the laws of nature, right? So now we can say is that I can't perceive of the cup as breaking the laws of nature, which means that the cup must be subject to the perception of this spirit which governs it. And the laws of nature are not material laws, they're rather eidetic laws. They're laws regarding ideas, and they're established by God. So that means the reason I can't make the idea of the cup levitate is because that cup is subject to the will of an active spirit. Let's say active perceiver, okay? They can also perceive it when I'm not here as well, right? And so it has to be infinite and eternal. Okay, so that means that let's say here, 33, he says, the ideas imprinted on the senses by the author of nature are called real things. And those which exist, which is excited in the imagination, being less regular, vivid, and constant, are more properly called ideas or images of things which they copy and represent. So what's the difference? What makes something real? Right? There's the answer, right? Things are real when they're imprinted on the senses by the author of nature. They're the author of nature. He says, the ideas of sense are allowed to have more reality in them, that is to be more strong, you know, orderly and coherent than the creatures of the mind. But this is no argument that they exist without the mind. Again, the mind is always the key feature. To be is to be perceived, and therefore that which exists requires perception or a perceiver. Existence requires perception. So, and then he begins to sort of lay out how people would criticize some and object to some of these foregoing principles. And I'm not going to spend too much time on it. I will emphasize here, he says, the only thing whose existence we deny is that which philosophers call matter, a corporeal existence. So that means that even though he's saying that the cup and the animal and the phone and the computer and the person, everything we experience is simply an idea, it doesn't have a material existence, he's not saying that doesn't mean it's real. What's real is when it's subject to nature. That's what the real perceptions are. And it doesn't mean that we're denying their existence either. We think there really is a cup here. It just so happens to be the case that the cup is simply an idea. And so he's saying here that's not the denial of existence. So this means that Berkeley's metaphysics and epistemology is not akin to a form of skepticism, though you might find it quite humbling to take his conclusions seriously. Right, he says it's evident to everyone in those things which were called the work of nature, that is, that the far greater part of the ideas or sensations perceived as are not produced or dependent on the wills of men. So the ideas we have, the ideas we have about cups, about art, all of those things, maybe not art. I was meaning sort of things that are created by artists. Those ideas, right, are clearly independent of our will, because we can't just force a change in them through sheer imagination. So that's what makes them independent. He says, but if we attentively consider the constant regularity, order, and concatenation of natural things, the surprising magnificence, beauty, and perfection of the larger, and the exquisite contrivance of the smaller parts of creation, together with the exact harmony and correspondence of the whole, but above all, the never enough admired law of pain and pleasure and the instincts of natural inclinations, appetites, and passions of animals. I say, if we consider all those things and at the same time attend to the meaning and import of the attributes, one eternal, infinitely wise, good, and perfect, we shall clearly perceive that they belong to this aforesaid spirit, who works all in all, and by whom all things consist. Hence it is evident that God is known as certainly and immediately as any other mind or spirit whatsoever, distinct from ourselves. We may even assert that the existence of God is far more evidently perceived than the existence of men. What is he saying there? He's saying that if once we get rid of the notion of abstract ideas, we see that to be is to be perceived. And that ultimately, if you can't perceive it, it can't exist. So that means that matter doesn't exist. But what maintains the existence of things, since they're ideas, deductively must require some being, some perceiver that's ultimately able to do this. And it's required because we are, in fact, having perceptions of things. We do, in fact, have ideas. So that means that there is an absolute infinite perceiver. So we see here that with Berkeley, the metaphysics concludes in the argument of a deduction for God's existence. He says, "He alone it is who it is He, God alone, who upholding all things by the world of His power, maintains that intercourse between spirits whereby they are able to perceive the existence of each other. And yet this pure and clear light, which enlightens everyone, is itself invisible." It's quite beautifully said here, but this means that it looks like Berkeley is committed to a form of metaphysical idealism that seems to utilize God in a way that's very similar to what we saw in Leibniz's monadology. So we see a lot of interesting things. Remember, Leibniz is one of these rationalist philosophers. Now we're seeing some, the same insight, but from an empiricist perspective. Okay, this concludes our discussion for today. And so I want to thank you so much for joining us in our discussion of George Berkeley. We will see you guys online in our next video series. I believe next we're going to be taking a look at the most important, I think, of the empiricist philosophers, John Locke. So thank you everyone for watching the video. I look forward to seeing you guys next time, and we'll see you online. Talk to you later. Bye.